So recently, I've been playing a lot more narrative-based games over on my Twitch, and during this time I've been able to revisit old stories I love like Life is Strange and Firewatch, as well as trying out newer titles like Night in the Woods. And I found a particular love for these indie narrative experiences. Something about the way these smaller indie games tell their stories and craft their narratives resonates with me on a far more personal level, and despite having played it nearly a year ago, one of the games that stuck with me was ironically 2016's Oxenfree. On the surface, Oxenfree is very easy to explain. It's one of those side-scrolling, walking and talking simulators, the kind of stuff that cropped up in the mid-2010s after the success of the Telltale games. I suppose you could loosely describe it as a horror game, in the same way you could loosely describe something like Scooby-Doo as a horror show. Throughout the game, the player character Alex and her friends, Ren, Clarissa Nona, and new stepbrother Jonas, accidentally open a series of interdimensional rifts that threaten to unleash a group of angry spirits. You know, typical teenager stuff. And while exploring the island, you begin to discover more and more about the people you made your trip with. And although Ren and Clarissa both have established histories with Alex, Jonas and Nona don't. Yet the game does such a great job at teasing out the history between all of them in such gentle ways that the story very quickly pivots from supernatural mystery into a fascinating series of character studies. Because once you scratch below the surface of Oxenfree, you quickly discover the game's really multiple stories all stacked on top of each other. Of course, there's the supernatural mystery of the island and uncovering what happened to the ghosts, who call themselves the Sunken, what caused the rift and their connection to the island's mysterious reclusive benefactor Maggie Edler. But mixed in with all of that is a series of very intriguing and honest characters. In a game like this, getting the characters right is crucial to the experience. When we talk about what makes games good, it can be split fairly distinctively between technical and narrative. On the technical side, we have things like gameplay, level progression, graphics, while on the narrative side, we have things like the plot, the settings, the characters. And because of its relatively simple approach to the more technical aspects, the game relies more heavily on those narrative side of things to pull in and retain player engagement. But even then, the narrative concepts in Oxenfree could at first glance be accused of being one-dimensional. An isolated location, cut off from civilization with an odd group of teenagers, some evil ghosts and a reclusive old woman are basically tropes pulled from every standard horror movie. However, as we and Alex spend more time exploring, talking to and helping everyone, they began to gradually reveal themselves. And a good way to show this happening is actually with the island itself. At face value, Edward Island is nothing more than a cheap tourist trap, a small town with a beach being its main attraction. However, as you continue to explore, you uncover more and more secrets. The abandoned military academy, which hints at a past that's more complex than the one presented to the public, the strange bunkers that are tied into the radio system, and all around the island, little cairns and secrets that, when accessed, begin to uncover the history of not only the island, but the shared story of the Sunken and Maggie. As you play, through either garbled messages, collectibles, or even hidden Morse code, you can discover exactly what caused the Sunken. You discover how decades ago the island was a military base working on experimental radio technology, and one day a submarine, the Kanaloa, sent out a distorted distress signal. It was picked up by Maggie Adler, who was working as a comms officer at the time, and she mistook it as a hostile attempt at radar jamming and ordered the ship's destruction, which seemingly killed everyone on board. But the crew and its passengers survived. Separated from their existence in our dimension, they continued to broadcast a distress signal out to the island. And after Maggie discovered this, she made it her life's work to try and help the spirits of the soldiers she feels she killed. With her friend Anna, the pair reach out and make contact with the Sunken, who are now reduced to childlike qualities and operating as a single hive mind. And when they try to free them, the Sunken instead trap Anna. Anna's story is one of the saddest side stories I think I've ever encountered in gaming. And Part of that comes from the fact that most players will actually miss it. The Morse code that I mentioned earlier, that you can decode in real life, that's from Anna, and it shows her going from trying to reach out and reassure Maggie that she's okay and she's safe, to gradual fear and an eventual complete loss of identity. It's an incredibly important part of the story because it shows how the Sunken ended up how they are. They've become consumed by this hulking mass of collective anger, so an individual identity has become something that's impossible for them to hold on to. They've forgotten who they are and have sat and watched as the world has forgotten them too. Their deaths were covered up, and then eventually a tourist town was built around their memories. Even the false narrative of brave soldiers dying in combat is mostly forgotten about by the time Alex and her friends arrive. They're in pain, they're scared, and most of all, they're angry. And it's this anger that drives them. They cling on to it because it's all they have left. It's only by helping them move on from this feeling and letting go that Alex can escape the island with all of her friends intact. Moving on and letting go are the central themes that Oxenfree's entire narrative focuses on. Everything from picking up discarded radio transmissions to her conversations with her friends is about letting go to some extent. Even the gameplay goes far to show this, having the characters be looped through and flung around in time, forced to relive events from the night over and over and over again. Jonas is a great introduction to this. When you first meet him, he shows himself off as a typical bad boy, a teenage smoker and someone who's had a hard past with run-ins with the law and struggled academically. But as the story goes on, his insecurities come to light and they break through his cold and laid-back exterior. The more you hang out with him, the more he opens up to Alex. He's a deeply sensitive character and just hides it behind the brash exterior. As the night goes on, he and Alex are followed by music that his deceased mother used to listen to, and he can even hear her humming along to it. It's made very clear early on that he deeply cares for and misses her. He talks about how events he didn't enjoy as a kid, like going on holiday with his parents to Missouri, are now cherished as containers for the memories that he can hold on to. Of course, when it comes to letting go, the two characters that personify this the most are Alex and Clarissa. At the start of the game, Clarissa's presented as nothing more than the stereotypical mean girl, whose connection to the wider group is that she's Ren's neighbor and Nona's friend, and seemingly, Alex's bully. However, as the story goes on and Alex is forced to confront more and more about her own past, we discover that the pair of them were actually much closer than initially presented. And this shared history is the reason the pair are so hostile to each other, since they both experienced the same tragedy, the death of Alex's brother and Clarissa's boyfriend, Michael. Michael is what brings the game's central theme to life. His death explains a lot about the reason as to why characters are the way they are. Why Jonas has arrived in Alex's life, the reason she's so detached from everyone around her, and why Clarissa is so angry, which makes her the perfect host for the Sunken. The sad thing is, you can tell without either of them ever saying it that Alex and Clarissa both feel a sense of anger at the other one, while also blaming themselves for Michael's death. Alex has the option to leave Clarissa to be possessed by the ghosts and save everyone else, while Clarissa insists on embarrassing and degrading Alex whenever given the opportunity. Eventually, Alex's time hopping actually takes her further back than a few hours, and she's thrown a whole year in the past, to the last time she visited the island with Michael and Clarissa. Here, we discover that Michael wanted to leave town, go to college with Clarissa, elope to New York, but before he does, the pair go swimming together, where Michael, just like the ghosts, drowns. Alex feels a huge amount of guilt over this, but all of the major characters are experiencing some form of guilt, or anger, or grief. For Clarissa and Alex, it's Michael. For Jonas, it's his mum. The Sunken, their own deaths, and for Maggie, the part she had to play in it. It fuels their actions, and in turn, the players. By the time I'd reached the end of the game, I was feeling pretty confident and happy with my choices. I'd done everything right. Not only had I gotten all the collectibles, read all of Maggie's letters, decrypted the radio signals, decoded the Morse code, I even went back and saved Michael. I let Jonas see his mum one last time, and I spared all my friends from losing their bodies to the Sunken. So as we were sitting on the boat, riding away from Edward Island, Michael re-added to our party, I leaned back in my chair with a smile and listened to Alex explaining what happened next in the voiceover. How Nona fulfills her dream and goes off to ballet academy, Ren conquers his fear of change and goes off to study in California, how Michael and Clarissa's relationship is going strong and with nothing to wedge a divide between them, both her and Alex have a fairly good friendship going. But then this happened.
I'm taking some time off. Just to I don't know, readjust my priorities, figure out what I want to do. But anyways, what time is it? Yeah, sorry, I gotta run or I'll miss the ferry. Ren's dragging me out to Edwards Island for that yearly beach party thing. And I have to pick up what's-his-name Jonas, too. I hope he's not weird or mean or something. Whatever, I'm sure it'll be fun. It's something to do, right?
Alex, like the Sunken, is stuck. She's forced to go through this night again and again. Sure, things might change. Nona and Ren might be dating. Clarissa could have been lost. Everyone ends up separated and hating each other. But no matter what, every ending leads back to the island. Even if you get the New Game Plus ending where Alex radios herself in the past and convinces them to never come to the island, the player is given the option to continue the loop. Now, there's a lot of different theories out there about Oxenfree. Some say it isn't time travel, it's parallel worlds. Some say there are multiple Alexes around, and I have my own ideas. The Sunken tell Alex they don't cause the loops and that they've been trapped in one of their own. And I think that's because the loop is fueled by anger and grief and a desire to hold on to the past. Every character who the Sunken target is clinging onto something from the past. Jonas has his mum, Alex and Clarissa have Michael, Ren has his love for a simpler time, before adulthood when they were all just stupid kids doing stupid things. The only character who's mostly spared of possession is Nona, and that's because she doesn't have anything from the past to cling on to. Even when Alex doesn't go to the island, the player's given the option to continue the loop, because in that timeline, she doesn't allow herself to confront her grief. The sailors never get a chance to move on and escape. Alex and Clarissa will never find common ground in which they can heal. Nona and Ren will never get together or conquer their fears of the future, and Jonas and Alex don't get a chance to bond. The same thing happens if she saves Michael. She doesn't confront her own sadness as much as patch over it with an easy and quick solution. Even then, that causes her to meddle with other people's lives to improve her own. Jonas and his father are never given a chance to move on from their pain. Is their happiness worth less than Alex's? No matter what scenario you move towards, everyone will either lose the chance to move on with their lives, or you have Alex caught in an endless loop, trying to find the perfect solution that can absolve her of her guilt and grief. But it'll never come as long as she continues to relive the events of that night and her brother's death, because everyone, her, Clarissa, Jonas, Ren, Nona, Maggie, and the Sunken, they're all clinging to the past, trying to make some kind of sense of it, or just unable to let go. And to me, that's what the game is about, moving on, learning how to live in the world and let go of the things that hurt you. The only way that Alex can do that is if we choose not to take her back, if we simply stop and don't continue. And that's really what I feel Oxenfree is trying to say. It's asking their audience if they can let go of the past, not only the struggles of Alex, Jonas, and the others, but of their own. And this is hard. I'm sure everyone watching has a plan of things they would do differently if they got a do-over. Things you would or wouldn't say, people you'd avoid or make more effort to get to know, and things you never did that years later you wished you had. But life doesn't have a do-over button. You can't reload the checkpoint and you can't walk back in time to get it right. Instead, you have to move on and deal with those questions scratching at the back of your mind. Despite how much I enjoyed the game and how much I'd love to hear more from these characters, I struggle to justify playing it again. It's a fantastic narrative experience with amazing mysteries and mystique, and it asks a lot of questions of the player. Is letting go something they can do? It's challenging them to leave the past in the past and presenting the question, is it possible to allow yourself to go on and move into a better tomorrow? Or to put it another way,